Thank you for joining us at Community on Demand. Today's message is presented by Dan Greer. Dan holds a doctorate from Grace School of Theology and is the senior pastor here at Community Church. This message was recorded during a live Sunday morning service at Community. Let's listen in as Dan begins.
I don't know if you know this or not, but San Francisco, the city of San Francisco, was actually founded on June 30th, 1776, 5 days before the Declaration of Independence. Right there on the peninsula. And it was a nice little hamlet, a really nice little place. By 1900, this unimportant little town became the largest city on the West Coast, with one quarter of the state's population living right there in the city limits of San Francisco. But today, in 1945, you may not know that the United Nations moved opened its headquarters in San Francisco, and then 5 years later moved it to New York City. Today, the San Francisco, Oakland, and San Jose metropolis, the Bay Area, has a population of over 9.5 million people and a gross domestic product of $1.25 trillion in 2021. San Francisco Bay Area is the headquarters for companies like Wells Fargo, Salesforce, Uber, Airbnb, Twitter, Levi's, Gap, Dropbox, and Lyft. And in 2019, it was the fifth most visited city in America, with over 3.3 million people visiting San Francisco to see things like the cable cars, Golden Gate Bridge, the Alcatraz, and Chinatown. San Francisco came to be known as the Queen City of the Pacific Coast. I've heard people tell me this is the most beautiful place they had ever visited. Unbelievable place. But there's a hidden little secret that's beginning to emerge from San Francisco. One of those secrets is that inflation has skyrocketed in the town, in so much that an income of $100,000 a year is only worth $36,000 in San Francisco due to high taxes and the cost of living, as compared with $81,000 here in the Houston area. Inflation is out of control. Also, another stat is that 633,000 residents of San Francisco are living below the poverty level. Homelessness has become the major issue, with over 8,000 people living on the streets in 2019, and over $850 million that has been earmarked in the city budget for to deal with the homeless situation they have. In 2018, the second most frequent complaint among residents in San Francisco, you probably have heard this, is human feces on the sidewalk. The second most frequent complaint. The top employer in the city is the city government, with 25,000 employees, while retail stores are closing and companies are making a mass exodus from the city. So far, the retail stores that have closed include Saks, Old Navy, Whole Foods, Office Depot, Nordstrom, Banana Republic, and the Container Store. All of these have closed. And companies like PayPal, I have a list here somewhere, like Twitter, PayPal, Airbnb, Salesforce, and Bank of America have moved out of the city. And today, Union Square, which is a huge retail sector there in the city, is experiencing a staggering 47% vacancy rate. Well, they're just boarding it up. People can't make it there anymore. And in 2021, the Hoover Institute, which is a conservative think tank there in San Francisco, rated San Francisco as dangerous more than 98% of all cities in the U.S. because of the skyrocketing crime rate. That beautiful city of long ago seems to be crumbling as if it were experiencing another 1906 earthquake. You know, as I witnessed the collapse of the structure of places like San Francisco and Portland and Seattle and New York, and the migration of those of people from those places to our area, I sometimes wonder, I sometimes worry that we may follow suit, that we may just become like that. It's my hunch that failures of this magnitude in areas like this can be attributed to flawed values, moral failure, and misguided ideology. They're just getting it wrong. But while most of us will welcome the migration of people from other areas, the question we struggle with whether the migration is bringing hidden agendas, hidden philosophies, and concepts that come with them that might start dragging our area down. We think about those things, don't we? So the question is, how can we influence the influx? I mean, if God has sent us these people, how can we influence them? How can we turn thinking around? How can we instill biblical concepts that will impact these people for the better and encourage inner growth and abundant life as people move into our area? How can we do that? You know, in his kingdom parables, Jesus is casting a vision for us and for his disciples on what the kingdom of heaven will be like, the coming kingdom of Christ's kingdom on earth. What will it be like? And he gives us some descriptions or some metaphors on what it would be like. Here's the idea. Is for his disciples and for us that are reading this to catch that vision, to embrace that vision, and to employ some of the principles of that vision right here, right now, in the kingdom of God that is both now and forever. We employ those things, and can we reap some of the benefits? That's the whole idea. In Matthew 13:33, Jesus gives a very strange parable. It's just called the parable of leaven. I titled the sermon, Hidden Leaven in the Kingdom of Heaven. Now, a lot of times people think that leaven has a picture sin in the Bible. But here Jesus is saying that the kingdom of heaven will be like leaven. And he goes on in that parable, and he gives some things to his disciples. He gives them a metaphor. Then for some strange reason, he gives them a measurement right there in the parable, this short parable. And then he gives them a message. We're going to kind of take this parable, the short parable of leaven in heaven, and we'll tear it apart and see what Jesus was trying to cast for his disciples to look at. First of all, he gives them a metaphor. We see the metaphor right there in verse 33a. It says, another parable he spoke to them, the kingdom of heaven is like leaven. Very straightforward. Here's what Jesus is doing. If you kind of watch the pattern here, up until this particular parable, he has had us out in the field, right? Sowing seed, harvesting wheat, planting mustard seed. But now what he does is he takes us out of the field and into the kitchen where we can do some baking. Do you kind of see the pattern there? And the main ingredients that he focuses on, he mentions the bread, But the main ingredient that he focuses on here in this parable is leaven. Baker's yeast is what he's focusing on. Now, you've got to understand something. When we see that, when I see that, I just imagine Gayla calling me and saying, could you run to the store and get some coffee and some bread and some yeast cakes? I hate her to do that. I said, what is a yeast cake? You know, well, you just go over there in the parable thing and just go ask somebody, you know. And okay, I'll do that. But in Bible times, people did not go down to the store and buy yeast cakes, baking soda, baking powder, or active yeast. They did not do that. How did they get it? What they would do is they would take a small ball of dough, flour, dough, mixed up with water. And they would take a damp rag and put it on the cabinet or the windowsill, and then they would take that small ball of dough and put it on that damp rag. And then it would just sit there. And something miraculous would happen. It's really not miraculous. Here's what would happen is that these tiny microscopic organisms that are floating around in the air that come from some of the funguses that are in the house and that are out in the yard, they're floating around and they come and they see this little clump of dough and they begin to be attracted to the dough and they land on the dough and then they begin to put off CO2 and it begins to become a little ball of leaven. Sometimes they'll cover it back up. Sometimes they'll bring it out. But they had leaven. The lump became leaven, or what some of you would call starter dough. Let me just take a poll right here. How many of you have used starter dough? I find myself among some of the few. I've done that before. It's the coolest thing in the world. Get some, you know, starter dough. And that's what they had. Now, this is, we don't see that. We read it, we say, leaven, what's leaven? How do they do it? But when someone from Jesus' day would read that, all of these things are going on in their mind. Get the dough, put it down, watch the little microscope. They thought it was magical, maybe. But it would happen, and then they could take the yeast, the little ball of yeast, and put it in the flour. Jesus is painting a vivid picture, an image, a metaphor here. He said, the kingdom of heaven is like this. Folks, what they're thinking is that when they enter the kingdom of heaven, all of a sudden, the unseen things and the miraculous things of God's kingdom of heaven on earth that have been unseen and invisible suddenly come alive and are seen. And people begin to absorb those things and it makes us grow. Do you see that? It changes character. It amazes. It impacts. It absorbs. And the formerly invisible things, the truths of his kingdom. That is kind of the metaphor that he's throwing out there. And they're thinking this. Then he goes on. And he gives them a measurement. Let's continue to read. Which a woman took, there's the leaven, which a woman took and hid in 3 measures of meal till it was all leavened. Now I know you don't know how much 3 measures are, so I'm going to give you that scholarly information right now, okay? It's about 100 pounds of wheat flour. Now, imagine for a moment. Let's put ourselves in that setting. Imagine for a moment going down to Costco and buying a 100-pound sack of whole wheat flour, coming home and putting it on your cabinet. Opening the bag, dumping it out on your cabinet, and then begin to knead the leaven into and water and all you need to. You said, who in the world would do that? That's the point here. Is that what he's saying here is that the kingdom of heaven is like leaven that is added to a bushel of whole wheat flour. Do you know how much that would make? Well, for FYI, if you don't leaven it, it'll make exactly 225 servings of spaghetti, okay? If you want to know. Or if you leaven it, it will make like 120 loaves of 1 pound light bread. What in the world are you talking about, Jesus? He's saying that it's going to grow. That one little ball of leaven added to 100 pounds is going to overcome the kitchen, is going to overcome the house, and all of a sudden you've got 120 loaves of bread, freshly baked, when it's added to the flour. You know, growing up, we would take an annual vacation from Midland, Texas to Monroe, Rabel, Shreveport, Louisiana area. And that's before Interstate 20 was in, and so we'd go down Highway 80, and we'd come into Fort Worth. I'd always remember this. We'd come into Fort Worth, and we would pass Mrs. Baird's Bakery. How many of you have done that? We'd pass the bakery, and I was always excited about it because as we'd pass by, we could smell the freshly baked bread there at that bakery, that Mrs. Baird's Bakery. Let me tell you a little story about Mrs. Baird's. In 1908... her name was actually Ninny Baird. My great-great-grandmother's name was Ninny Cobb, so I was familiar with this. Her name is Ninny Baird. And what Ninny did is that she used a wood-burning stove behind the house, not even in the kitchen, behind the house, to bake bread to supplement their income. And she would try to make a dozen or so loaves of bread a day. And then she went to the Metropolitan Hotel and spent $75 to buy a gas-burning stove to bring back over to the house to use. And with that, she could actually bake 400 loaves of bread every day. She started selling it to the neighbors. That actually pretty good. She paid $75 for it. Then that was in 1915. Then in 1919... she and her sons, I think she had about 8 children, she and her sons took an old Ford and converted it to a truck and made a delivery truck out of it. They were using a horse and buggy and began using a truck and started delivering bread around the neighborhood. And that seemed to be going pretty good. And then 1917, that was in 1917, in 1928, she jumped way out and bought a piece of property and opened a plant in Dallas, Texas that could make 125,000 loaves of bread per week. Now she's in business. And then she went from there and went to Fort Worth and built that brick building that could bake 400 loaves at a time. And then in 1953, she built a new plant on Mockingbird Lane in Dallas, Texas, that became the world's largest automated bakery. It could produce 2 million pounds of bread per week. And by 1959, Mrs. Baird owned 5 plants, producing 6 million pounds of bread per week. And by 1980, the company had 2,500 employees and plants in Houston and Dallas and Lubbock and Waco, Victoria and Austin. Mrs. Baird died at 92 years old on June the 2nd, 1961, and the state senate was so impressed with her, they made a resolution in memory of her declaring Ninny Baird a living example for mothers, wives, business executives, Christians, and good people the world over. She learned the parable of the leaven right here and right now, literally speaking. And what God is saying, and what Jesus is saying here, is that the same principle is going to occur in the coming kingdom of Christ on earth. What are you saying? It is going to have spectacular growth. It is going to be wonderful. It is going to be delicious. It is going to be an incredible place when the Lord comes and sets his kingdom up on earth. The kingdom of heaven will be explosive, uncontrollable. We will discover and absorb all of the wonderful, magnificent, hidden truths of his coming kingdom. So he gives them the metaphor, the measurement here. And then he actually goes on a step farther, quotes Psalm 78, and gives them a message. Look down in verse number 34. All these things Jesus spoke to the multitudes in parables. And without a parable, he did not speak to them, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the prophets, saying, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things kept secret from the foundations of the world. So far, as we have been reading down through Matthew chapter 13, we will see that he has used the word parable 10 times. Sowing seed, harvesting wheat, planting mustard, and here hidden leaven. He's talking about the sowing of his word, the gathering of his saints, the planting of his sons, the growing of the kingdom of heaven. All of these parables and metaphors he was putting together as he is describing what the coming kingdom of heaven is going to look like. All of these parables have been agricultural metaphors to imply that when we get to heaven, there's going to be natural, phenomenal, incredible growth in the coming kingdom of heaven. I am so excited about that. It just seems like everything I try to do just goes backwards, you know? And here, the coming kingdom of heaven is going to be spectacular with numeric growth, spiritual growth, ecological growth, economic growth, relational growth, emotional growth, no more confusion, no more depression, great growth in the coming kingdom of heaven. I don't know about you, but I'm ready. I want to see that day. Things are getting rough here. Things are getting confused. Kids can't figure this out. I look forward to the return of Christ, setting his kingdom up on earth, and the growth of the kingdom of heaven. But it hadn't come yet. We're still here. So how can we benefit from some of these teachings and some of these principles right now, right here, while we're still on the planet? How can we do that? How can we draw from that passage of Scripture? Well, or can we draw from it? Or do we just say, okay, let's wait until it happens? Or can we reach in and pull some of these principles out? Now, the answer is yes, we can. In order to do that, again, let me say this again. We must catch the vision of the coming kingdom, and we must discover three kinds of hidden leaven right here and right now as we think about the coming kingdom. And so Jesus goes on to pick it up and explain it as we continue to read. The first thing we must do is we must be aware of the leaven of indoctrination. Skip all the way down to Matthew 16. Let me just read this to you. Then Jesus said to them, his disciples, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Now, he didn't say this right after doing the kingdom parables. He said this after the feeding of the 5,000, the feeding of the 4,000, the walking on the water, and several other things. Jesus gives his disciples another short lesson on leaven that has a negative context this time. And what I love about it is they got it. They figured it out. Look down in verse number 12. Talk about the disciples. Then they understood that he did not tell them to beware of the leaven of bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. What is the doctrine of the Pharisees and the Sadducees? Well, the doctrine of the Pharisees, we saw it unfold. They were into legalism. They were into works-oriented salvation. They were into tradition. They were into making, you know, burdening down people with all kinds of rules and regulations. Forget the relationship. They were oppressing. They were pushing. They were ruling. Legalism. Pharisees. Well, what about the Sadducees? Well, that's a different sort. They were more liberal. They didn't believe in the resurrection. They couldn't understand the kingdom of heaven. They had a completely different context or concept of what was being taught. No resurrection. But what these two had in common is they both resisted Jesus. They resisted his teaching. They resisted his opening their eyes and revealing. They resisted his Olivet Discourse telling about the future. And let me show you what happens back over the book of Proverbs when we resist, when we push it back, when we don't see, when we close our eyes to the things of God and can't catch the vision about the kingdom of heaven. In Proverbs chapter 29, verse 18, it says, "Where there is no revelation, the people cast off restraint." That's exactly what's happening in America today. Pulpits have quit preaching revelation, teaching the kingdom of heaven. We're into social gospel stuff. We're into pampering people rather than exposing the what is to happen in the future. And what has happened in our culture is that everyone is cast off restraint. Everyone does everything that they want to do, and all kinds of crazy indoctrination is happening. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, were the scholars of the day. Pharisees taught works-oriented salvation. Sadducees taught no resurrection. While they were teaching this, the Romans were teaching moral corruption, confusion. And the end result was chaos and complete social breakdown of their culture during that time. And again, I say, while many pulpits in America have stopped teaching grace and have stopped teaching the coming kingdom of Christ on earth, our scholars are indoctrinating our kids with moral corruption and confusion. So what he's saying here is that we must become aware of this. We must become aware of this growing leaven, this negative growing leaven. Catch the vision of the kingdom of heaven. Commit ourselves to teaching and training this generation to turn this ship around. That is what we must do as we become aware of those things. Second thing he teaches is that we must be attached to the leaven of increase. Now, we're going to go to Luke chapter 13. We did this last week. This is a different place and a different situation, and Jesus is teaching somewhat of the same parable or the metaphor with a little bit of a different nuance. In Luke chapter 13, verse 20 and 21, it says this, "And he said," Jesus said, "to what shall I liken the kingdom of God?" He changes from heaven to God. "It is like leaven which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal until all was leavened." Now remember, as we mentioned last week, it seems as though the kingdom of heaven is speaking of the coming kingdom of Christ on earth. And the kingdom of God seems to be speaking of God's universal reign both now and forever. And that is what he says here, that the kingdom of God will be like leaven. I want you to notice something here in Luke chapter 13. Jesus is teaching in a synagogue, not on the shore of the sea. And what's interesting here, he only gives two parables in this setting. The parable of the mustard seed. And if you remember last week, we talked about that. And one of the things that I said last week is that the mustard seed is like a microcosm of the kingdom of heaven. The church is like a microcosm of the kingdom of heaven. It is planted, it grows, and we made that comparison. And we worship together and glorify God together. We mentioned that last week. That is the only other parable. Then he gives the parable of the leaven, where the hidden things of God cause us to grow in maturity. So I think that the principle here is this. We must attach ourselves to the local church and associate ourselves with its growth. Our mentality must be to catch the vision of drawing, winning, teaching children, teens, and adults the principles of the Word of God that would change their hearts and help them have the vision of the coming kingdom and apply those principles and begin to grow spiritually. It is God's Word planted in our lives that changes us and His Spirit. We must make that association. So what he's saying here right now is we must be aware of the leaven of indoctrination. We must be attached to the leaven of increase and growth. I mean, that needs to be our mentality. You say, how is that mentality? Again, what is our mission statement here? Our mission is to draw, our mission is to create an environment that draws people to Christ, equipping them to reach others. Our mentality should be to draw people to Christ. Evangelism, discipleship. We ought to be thinking, this person doesn't know the Lord. I met someone this last week that doesn't know the Lord. I'm really excited about trying to draw that person into a relationship with Christ. So we must be aware of the leaven indoctrination. We must be attached to the leaven of increase. And we must be against the leaven of insincerity. And in Luke chapter 12 and verse 1, he says this again. Beware the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. At first it was their doctrine, and now it is their mentality, their hypocrisy. You know, if you go to counting in the Bible, Jesus calls out the Pharisees for what they are, what they were, insincere hypocrites. And as you start counting, he will actually call them to their face 15 times, you scribes, you Pharisees, you hypocrites, you hypocrites, you hypocrites, you hypocrites. Over and over and over, he's calling the religious people of that day, the religious scholars of that day, insincere hypocrites. Why is he so against hypocrites? I mean, if you can't do good, can't you just act good? Whether you're good, you know. Here's the reason. Our kids are struggling today. We may not be struggling. We may just be as happy as a June bug, you know. But our kids are struggling. Our young adults are struggling. They're having all of these voices that are coming to them from all kinds of media, and they're confused. And they're struggling with anxiety. We've talked about this before. They're struggling with confusion, depression, and they struggle with what is real and what is not. And when they see us as insincere, they can see right through us, and it damages their security. He calls it leaven. Hypocrisy grows. You see me being hypocritical, you'll say, it's okay, the pastor's hypocritical, I can be hypocritical too. And it spreads. The last thing they need is for us to be insincere and hypocritical. They need us to be real, authentic, committed to our faith in Christ, and committed to the coming kingdom of heaven. You've heard of Jonathan Edwards. He was a pre-American Revolution revivalist, a missionary. He was the president of Princeton University, and he's probably best known for that sermon he preached. You remember that sermon? Sinners in the hands of an angry God, right? I've read that sermon, scares you to death, you know. A Princeton scholar about 100 years later by the name of Benjamin Warfield in 1850 traced the descendants of Jonathan Edwards to just see what had happened from, I mean, he was sincere, you know. And here's what the Princeton professor discovered. He said the descendants of Jonathan Edwards included one U.S. president, Hayes, I think is who it was, one dean of law school, one dean of a medical school, three U.S. senators, three governors, three mayors, 13 college presidents, 30 judges, 60 doctors, 65 professors, 75 military officers, 80 public office holders, 100 lawyers, 100 clergymen, 60 authors, and 285 college graduates. Quite a legacy. About the same time the survey came out, there was a sociologist by the name of Richard Dugdale. And he noticed that there were some prisoners in the New York prison system, about 46 prisoners, and they were blood relatives to one another. They all came from the same ancestral line. So he decided that he would do an ancestral trace on these 42 prisoners, and he traced them all the way back to a frontiersman that lived during the same time that Jonathan Edwards lived by the name of Max Jukes, who was an atheist who lived wild during the time of Jonathan Edwards and those Puritan revivals. His genealogical tree included 7 murderers, 60 thieves, 192 prostitutes, 150 convicts, costing the New York prison system $1.2 million in 1850, 310 paupers, 440 who were addicted to alcohol. Out of the 1,200 descendants of Max Juke that were studied, 300 died prematurely. Both good and bad leaven can have an impact on our kids' lives and those around them. In Matthew, Jesus says that the kingdom of heaven on earth is going to be like leaven. It's going to grow. It's going to be spectacular. Christ is going to be on the throne. Christians will be in his administration. There will be love, joy, peace, health, godliness, and goodness throughout the earth. And the glory of God will fill the earth. We ought to be excited about the coming kingdom of Christ. But the truth is, We are ambassadors of Christ right here, right now. As his ambassadors, we must attach ourselves to the vision. The vision of his coming kingdom, we must commit ourselves to the ministry of Christ right here and right now. That's what our vision here is at Community. Ambassadors of Christ. His coming kingdom is coming. You might ask, how do I do this? How exactly do I do this? Let me give you a couple of things. First of all, know that you're part of his coming kingdom by trusting Christ as your Savior. And I would just say the majority of everyone sitting here, not everybody sitting here today, has made that decision, made that commitment, knows Christ as their Savior. Becoming a believer, you know the words. Jesus said to Nicodemus, unless a man be born again, he shall not see the kingdom of God. Paul said to the Philippian jailer, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. And I like what he said afterwards, and your house, it's going to spread like leaven. And it did. Number two, get involved in his ministry. We're down to the end of the age. I think every one of us needs to pray and say, God, what do you want me to do? We're getting ready to, we're now into the fall. We're moving into the Christmas season not too long from now. People will be coming to church. What can we do? Where do you want me to serve? Let's pull ourselves together and see some of these benefits and principles happen right here, right now. The kingdom of heaven is like leaven. It is going to grow. It is going to be glorious. And you are invited to be a part of it.
On behalf of Pastor Dan and the folks at Community, thank you for joining us today at Community on Demand. Feel free to share this link with others, and please know you are always welcome to be our guest during a live service any Sunday morning at our campus in The Woodlands, Texas. For more information, just click on the link, www.cbcwoodlands.org. I hope you will again join us at Community on Demand.